Our keynote today is Kantis Simmons. Kantis has had over 25 years in school. Have you ever met someone who earned 3 college degrees but didn't pay a single penny? Have you ever met someone who performed in the Olympic Games and the very next day was working on a NASA military jet? Our speaker today is the author of Playing Your A Game. So if you could please put your hands together and give a warm welcome to Kantis Simmons.
Good morning. I said good morning.
Good morning.
How many people are super duper excited that it's summertime? Y'all funny, right? So a few years ago, there was this mother and she was pregnant. And this mom, she was going in just for a regular checkup. And all of a sudden, as she started walking, she felt this in her stomach. She was like, "Whoo! I hope that isn't gas." So she kept walking, she kept walking. Whoo! It happened again. She was like, "Whoo! Whoo! Doctor, I think the baby is coming." So they rush into the living room, laid on the table, out comes this shiny black baby boy. Nyack, nyack, nyack. And this mother looked down at her new baby boy. She said, "Wow, my baby is so pretty." But at the same time this mother noticed her new baby boy, this mother, she started going through these emotions. On one hand, she was super duper excited. "Oh God, thank you for my baby." And at the exact same time, she was confused and disappointed. One minute she was elated, the next minute she was deflated. It was almost like she had bipolarism on that day. And so this mother asking herself, "How in the world did this happen?" And you say, "What?" Well, this mother looked down at her new baby boy. She realized that her baby boy was missing some of his fingers. Yes, that was my mom a few years ago, about 18 years ago. And you know, at that time period, when I came out the womb, my mother had questions going on in her mind. But it's from that day that my mom, she sort of instilled in me a few things. She said, "Son, you can be whatever you want to be. You can do whatever you want to do, and you can have whatever you want to have. Just allow your hopes to outweigh your fears." Now, I want to say to you today that the bald guy with the beard, with the glasses on, I hadn't always been this cool. I hadn't always been this confident. Because there were some years ago that I battled with insecurity, I battled with low self-esteem, and I battled with a whole bunch of mess. You see, it started in the 5th grade. There was this girl named Keisha. I saw Keisha at school. I was like, "Ooh, Keisha." And I said, "Hey, Keisha, how you doing?" Well, I didn't say it like that. I had bass in my voice. "Hey, Keisha, how you doing?" "Hello, my name is Kantis." She said, "Ooh, hold up, wait a minute. What's wrong with your fingers?" She was like, I can't do it. You have the cooties. Ta-ta. A few years later, I was playing baseball. I wore the glove in this hand, and I had a line drive ball hit to me. Bow! I bobbled the ball, my glove fell off, I picked the ball up, and I threw the guy out at first base. As I walked back over to pick up my glove, I heard some parents in the stands say, "Ooh, look at his fingers. He's so special." A few years later, a few innings later, I was batting right-handed. Bow! Hit a single, ran down first base, save! The parents in the stands said, "Oh, look at his fingers. He's so special." The next thing I got up to bat, I was batting left-handed. Bow! Hit a double, touched first, slid in the second, save! I heard the parents say, "Hercules, Hercules, Hercules." It's so special. So now, not only do I have the cooties, but I'm also special. Has anybody ever participated in the marching band? A few people? Has anybody ever seen a marching band? Has anybody ever seen that movie, Drumline, with Nick Cannon? You seen that movie? Okay, well, that was my high school band. And I know in the movie, the name of the band was the Atlanta A&T Band. And that was my high school. And when I was in high school, I was the drum major. You know, the guy that would bring the band on the field with the whistle in his mouth and the hat on. It was my very first game. It was Southwest DeKalb High School versus Bunner High School. 15,000 people at halftime. It was time for the very first song, the Olympic fanfare. Everything slowed down. And I'm thinking to myself, what in the world is that flapping in the air? Now, if you've ever seen a marching band or a good marching band, we would wear white gloves on our hands, right? We had white gloves on our hands. And as I was directing the band, I just saw something flapping in the air. You know, those fingers that didn't have fingers in them? They were flapping in the air. So I'm thinking to myself, OMG, everybody in the stands was talking about my flapping fingers. So that night I went home, went to the bathroom, sat on the side of the tub, had the gloves on. I said, I have to do something about this. So I went to my mom's room, grabbed a needle and thread, came back with some scissors. I held the gloves up, those scissors, and as I was about to cut the gloves off, the fingers off, my mom busts into the bathroom. She said, boy, what are you doing? I said, Mom, I'm cutting off my flapping fingers. She said, what? I said, Mom, I'm cutting off my flapping fingers. She said, huh? I said, Mom, I'm cutting off my flapping fingers because everybody in the school is talking about me. She said, child, please. She said, put the scissors down, take that glove off, and son, I want you to hear something and never, ever forget it. She said, son, quit looking at what you don't have and think about all the amazing things you do have. It was those same words that got me through high school. Quit looking at what you don't have and think about all the amazing things you do have. And those words popped up for me the first day of that job interview. I was there at NASA Langley Research Center. Had on a blue suit, white shirt, gray tie, blue polka dot, black dress shoes. I was so fresh and so clean. And as I was sitting there, Dr. Hinckley was on the other side of the table, and he asked me a few questions, and it sounded like this. Walk, 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 walk. Walk, 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 walk. And as Dr. Hinckley was talking to me, I heard this foreign voice. You know, that voice of doubt. That voice that says, you probably should quit. That voice that says, dude, they're not gonna hire you. That voice that says, dude, you think they're gonna hire a handicapped scientist? Then I heard the voice of my mom. Son, quit looking at what you don't have and think about all the things you do have. Walk, 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 walk. Dude, you remember that time period that you was in college and you had the rubber gloves on and the beaker and the flapping fingers and the rubber gloves caught on fire in the science lab? Son, quit looking at what you don't have and think about all the things you do have. And Dr. Hinckley said, Kantis, congratulations. I'd like to welcome you here to NASA Langley Research Center. If you guys would, give it up for my mom. Give it up for my mom. So my name is Kantis Simmons, and I had the very first iPhone. I grew up as a cool nerd. Here's my mom and dad. My mom and dad was raised in a middle-class broke family. Anybody know about middle-class broke? Middle-class broke, got a nice mom, a nice dad, got a house, green grass, but you're always broke. Middle-class broke family, you would take vacations when? On the weekend. A vacation for us It was going to the Stone Mountain. I'm from Atlanta, Georgia. Or a really good weekend may get to go to Lenox Mall. And if it was a really good weekend, Six Flags. But my mom and dad impressed upon me the importance of education. And because of that, after being 6 weeks old, my mom popped me out of her belly, dropped me off at Young World Nursery. And I've been in school for 25 years. 5 years of pre-K, 7 years of elementary school, 5 years of high school, 4 years of college, 2 years of grad school at Lehigh University with a Master's of Polymer Science and Engineering, then 2 more years at Georgia Tech in Textile and Fiber Engineering. And that opened up some opportunities for me to work as a research scientist at NASA Langley, where I did some really cool things. I would pull things in the air, helicopters, planes, and just drop them, boop, and say, it doesn't work. Let's go do it again. Pull it in the air, boom, it doesn't work. Some years later, I left NASA, started working at SIBA Vision. Anybody wear contact lenses? Thank you for paying my mortgage, I appreciate it. Thank you. I worked on a project called VisiTint. These are a few products that I worked specifically on. VisiTint was if anybody wear contact lenses, you know when you drop your contact lens, you have a hard time trying to find it, and you see that glorious blue tint? That's VisiTint. And that was part of the project that, some technology that I worked on with this project here. Now SIBA Vision has been bought out by Alcon. For the last few years here now, coming up on a decade, I've been taking this message on STEM, taking this message on the importance of academic success all across the country, speaking at schools and colleges and conferences, also working with students and signing books and doing what I feel like is part of my purpose, working with teachers and educators. And so I'm so grateful that I'm here with you guys this weekend because I realize that you have a lot going on, right? You have a lot going on. And as I travel the country, I've shot a lot of videos, online podcasts and videos, working with students. But as I was in the business of working with students and motivating students, I realized that the students didn't need the motivation. It was the people that work with the students, the educators, the ones that are there, the ones that act like parents every single day, the ones that go home with somebody else's child that's not their own, right? And so because of that, I've made my business to serve you, serve students, and serve parents as much as I possibly can. So about a year ago, I shot a video and I posted it on YouTube. And I thought the video was going to be like, that's an awesome video. And I still think it was an awesome video. But I looked down at the comments of some of that video. And you can see it on Facebook and YouTube. And some of these comments of other educators jumped out to me. One person said, most teachers who leave the profession is due to bad management, data, curriculum changes, which is outdated and being undervalued. I left teaching recently, and no, it was not the kids, as that is a part of the job to teach, which is what all of us teachers are saying. Just let me teach my subject. Who says that? Just let me teach the class, right? She says, I feel your video is missing a key point. It's not about the marking exams and classroom management, etc., as that's to be expected as part of the role. It's more about senior leaders, curriculum boards, and governments so focused on meeting targets and criticizing us and making us feel undervalued, right? You've heard that before? Another person says, I think some people are taking this video the wrong way. It's not to criticize those who left the profession or to insinuate that they are somehow poor teachers because they made the decision to walk away. A decision I completely respect and fully understand. This video is to encourage those who are straddling the fence. I'm not going to lie. This video agitated me because I do want to quit. But it also did something else for me. It encouraged me to seek out success stories so that maybe, just maybe, I can perceive through or I can push through yet another year. The truth is I can. And that, my friend, is a very good thing. Had one other person say, when we stop blaming teachers for the failures of the education system is when we will begin to make progress. The teachers are part of the solution, not the problem. We need to get our funding priorities straight. Enable schools to permanently expel disruptive students and make parental participation a requirement for student enrollment. That's how you fix education, and that's how you prevent teacher burnout. Well, here's the thing I realized, right? We all know the different things that go on in our school system. I hear recently you guys had a major push going on. Red for Ed. Come on, give it up for Red for Ed. Right? You know, I watch ESPN all the time. Like, I really do. And I think about the amount of money some of these players are getting. And I said, man, if we just take LeBron James' salary and shift it over to this school district, we may have some teachers doing slam dunks as well. Right? Right? But I know that you're not in this profession because of the money, correct? So I have a new book coming out. It's called From Burned Out to Fired Up. And I want to share some of these things with you, if you don't mind. You wouldn't believe that, well, I didn't believe it initially, but I'm so surprised. You've probably seen this number, right? You've seen this number? Can I get everybody inside the room stand up for me? Yep, stand up, stand up, stand up. Everybody stand up on this side of the room. Stand up. About right in here and over. Stand up for me. That's what the numbers look like. So if we had to think about things, everybody inside of the room, you've given up, right? This is how the numbers look. So my presentation today is for the people on this side of the room, right? The people that's a part of the 54%. The people that says, you know what? I'm gonna give it one more year, just one more year. Okay, two more years. My bonus, my benefit package coming up real soon. I'll give it 3 more years. You know, I have spent a lot of time in the profession. I want all of my retirement, right? Give it up for the 54%. Give it up for the 54%. You guys may be seated. One of the things that I realized is that for many years, this was my mess. This was the thing that told me I can't, I won't, and I'll never. But I've also have allowed this mess to become my message. So I'm gonna give you everything I have today. I'm not gonna give you 10 points. I'm gonna give you 10 secrets. I'm gonna simply share 7.25 things with you. One, two, three, four, five, six, 7.25. I always give some love to my nub. Right? But these next few minutes, I want you guys to really think. If you got a pen, a piece of paper, I want you to write down these 7.25 questions. Because here's what I know, here's what I believe. You can only control what you can control. So let's say that I'm walking down a river. And as I walk down this river, my iPhone falls out of my pocket and falls into the river. Now, I may be tempted to jump in the river, but it's just an iPhone 7, right? I can go to the Apple store and get the iPhone X. But let's just say, if I was walking down the same river with my mother, David, and David, my mother fell into the river. Now, I've never seen my mother swim. iPhone 7 versus my mother. Now I have a bigger reason to jump into the river. Here's the first question I want to ask you, and I want you to think about. What's your reason for jumping in the river? You see, my mom is now my motivation for jumping in. My motivation or my motive for taking that deep dive to help her. In the teaching profession, where you are today, question number one, what's your why? What's your why? What's your why? I want to hear from a few teachers real quick here. let's talk to somebody who's been in the profession more than 10 years. Why are you in this profession? Yes, ma'am, right here. And what's your name?
Sharon.
Turn around this way so the people can see you. Say, hey, Ms. Sharon. So you've been in the profession for 70 years.
This will be my 17th year teaching.
Okay. Why?
I did not enjoy school. I was a very poor student growing up, and I had some terrible teachers. I had just a few who were quality, I felt, teachers.
Hold on, wait a minute. How old were you in school? Like 10? And you gonna tell them they was poor quality teachers?
Hindsight, maybe, I guess you'd say. But no, I didn't enjoy school, and I didn't graduate high school. I went to high school for 5 years, and I left without a high school diploma. So I kind of know what it's like not to be a successful student.
So your big reason why is that you want to...
I wanted to change how kids perceived school and teachers and to help them be successful.
Cool. You guys give it up for Ms. Sharon. Give it up for Ms. Sharon. Anybody else? So why, Mr. Craig, have you been in this profession? And how long?
I'll be starting 35.
What a minute. You were my elementary school teacher.
That's familiar.
I know. Okay, so 35 years. So tell us why for 35 years you've been in the profession.
I still love teaching kids. I'm just as passionate today as I was the first day I stepped in a classroom. It hasn't changed.
Awesome. Awesome. Great job. Somebody, let's say less than 5 years. Less than 5 years. What's your name?
Lejuna Ratcliffe.
So why?
Both my parents taught. My dad taught 23 years, my mom taught 33, and I saw teachers and the motivation and the impact they had on other lives, and after working in marketing for many, many years, I decided I wanted to have that kind of impact on lives too, to help others through difficult times when they're in high school.
Oh, you guys give it up for Ms. Ratcliffe. I want you guys to do something tonight as you're going through this week. If you're on social media, whether it be Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat, MySpace, whatever it is, right? I want you to state your why. We always post the best pictures on social media. But I want you to step out, regardless of what year you are in school right now or teaching this profession. I want you to state your why to your people. Be bold enough, you know, sometimes this week to state that, put that out there. Because what it does is that it gives you a reason, right? When things get rough, you can always go back to your why, right? I'm jumping in this river because I love my mother. I have a bigger reason for jumping in. So I want you guys to put that up there for me, all right? Question number two, how many people will say this is a profession or a calling? Who would say this is a profession? Who feels like they are in the teacher profession? Okay, who feels like I've been called to do this? Most people. Some people say, I'm not really sure, right? And the reason I say this is because, or ask this question, or I want you to answer this question, because now it goes back to your why. Like Mr. Craig said, hey, from day one, you love the students. And for 35 years, there's been something keeping you every single year, and hadn't been the money. Hadn't been, he's like, no, right? Right? So you feel called and compelled to impact somebody every single year. Right? So I believe it's a calling. I definitely believe it's a calling. You know, it's one of those professions that impacts the entire world. When I think about the person that taught Donald Trump, I'm like, somebody taught Donald Trump. Maybe they did. Maybe they did not. I'm not sure sometimes. But you impact every profession in the world. So quick question here. I need two participants. I want to sell this house to somebody. What's your name?
Angelina Cook.
Y'all say hi, Angelina. Step right here. What's your name, ma'am?
Victoria Dellery.
Y'all say hi, Victoria. Now, Angelina, Victoria, I'm going to ask you a trick question. Would you purchase this home?
No.
Why not?
Well, for starters, my husband and I just bought our first home. I don't want to go through all that paperwork again.
Okay. Ms. Victoria, why? Yes or no?
Nope.
because I can't afford it, and we like to live within our means.
Okay. Well, I live between my means. Okay. What if I gave you the house?
Even then, I don't know. Are you going to pay the electric and the heating and the air?
No. I'll pay the electric. I'll take the electric. We can go half on the gas, though.
Yeah. I'll take it.
You'll take it? Sold. All right. Angelina, would you buy this house?
No.
Why not? Listen, you just bought a house. You can sell that house, double your money to get this house.
Well, my husband and I have both worked very hard for the house that we have, so.
So you don't want this house?
I'm good.
Okay. Victoria, would you buy this house?
No, but if you give it to me, I'll make some equity on it.
You're kind of smart. So, Ms. Angelina, what year did you teach in school?
Kindergarten.
How long have you been teaching?
I just finished my first year.
She just finished her first year. Give it up for her. Awesome. And what's the name of the school?
Eagle Ridge Elementary School.
So your last name is Cook?
Yes, sir.
And you teach at what school?
Eagle Ridge.
So what if I change the name of the school to Cook Elementary School?
I think I'd cry. I want to become like a big educator, like advocate and everything else, and eventually open up my own school.
Wow. So would you name it like Cook Academy?
Maybe.
No, go ahead and say it. Come on. Put it in the atmosphere. Come on. I run
Cook Elementary School.
Cool. Say it with some confidence.
So I run Angelina Cook Elementary School.
Cool. Y'all give it up for her. So Miss Delary?
Yes.
Okay, cool. Miss Delary. What school do you teach at?
Deer Valley Middle School.
Deer Valley? Deer Valley in the house?
Yeah.
And your name is Delary.
Correct.
So what if we change it to Delary Academy?
I mean, I'm down.
You're down?
Yeah, but it's not my life dream like this wonderful lady.
So here's my big question for everybody, right? So we all teach at different schools, but what if we change the name of the school to Cook Academy, Delray High School? If we did that, how would the school run differently because your name is on it? Tell me.
Well, at least for my school, I would have I'm a big person who believes in open line of communication. So it'd be one of my things with my teachers and making sure that all the parents that they're talking with, because I feel like that makes the school year flow better. And, you know, even if you're having those difficult, you know, parents that they're just concerned for their kids because of all the stuff they see. And you just have to show them like, well, I'm not like those teachers that you see on the news. Like, I'm a totally different person. This is what I believe in my classroom, and having that. And then also showing them on teaching them their kids different ways in school.
So you would do that at Cook Academy?
Yeah.
Why aren't you doing that now?
I already am.
You already are?
I have 5 different ways I communicate with my parents. And I don't teach with worksheets in my classroom. I teach very hands-on. I get down on the floor with the kids, take them out for field trips around the school, I invite other teachers and the parents and like our PTSA and people to come into our classroom. Mm. So
Awesome. Ms. Delray, if your name was on the school, what would you do differently?
I would find a way to pay my teachers more because my school can't keep talent. We're a Title I. Real small, and teachers leave us constantly every year. We have like a 50% turnover, and it sucks. I would find a way to grow teachers and keep them at my school.
Awesome. So here's the question I have for everybody. Does your school, the quality of your school look like this or look like this? So your school looks like this. Here's the question for you. Question number 3, what's the name of your school? Here's what I want you to do. I want you to change the name of the school that you currently work with right now. Change it to your last name. Diamond Institute. Gold Hair Academy. And so here's the mindset, right? When your name is on the school, like you just said, you would do something different. I want everyone right now to start thinking about the school that you're in right now and change the name of your school. So what if the name of the school changed to your name, Academy? What would you do differently? You see the mindset now? Because many of our schools, it looks this way. What if this says Kantis Simmons Institute of America? Guess what? We're going to do our best to fix this thing up. And I want you guys to start thinking about that right now. Taking ownership of your school. Even though your name is not on the school, if your name, Fox High School, Fox School District, was the name, start thinking about what you would do differently and start instituting it, okay? Give these teachers a big round of applause. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. So Beyonce had this song a few years ago, and if you know the song, sing it with me. It says, to the left, in the box, to the left. So she tells this dude, like, look, you can leave, bye-bye, I'm irreplaceable. Got a question for you. How many people right now in the room can remember the first name and the last name of 10 teachers that impacted you while you were in school? How many people in the room can name the name of 5 teachers, that first name, last name, that impacted you while you were in school? 5. How many people can name the first name and last name of 2 teachers that impacted you to change your life? 2 teachers coming up. Wow. Some of y'all still sitting. Now, let me ask this question. Let's say 10 years from now, I'm speaking out of school, and I ask the students, hey, can you tell me a teacher, first name, last name, that impacted you so much that you still remember the impact they had on your life? Here's my question to you. Are you unforgettable? Meaning, what are you doing every single day to impact students? Tattoos, I believe, they've gotten out of hand, right? They're all on the neck and the face, the earlobe, the cheek, the forehead, right? But one thing about those tattoos, in most cases, like, they can't be removed unless you go through some strenuous removal process. What tattoos are you leaving on the minds of your students so they don't forget you? That's question number 4 there. Real quickly here, are you a whiner or a planner? We've all been in those meetings, right? Yeah, we don't have enough money in our school. Yeah, they can't take the books home. Yeah, we need a raise. Yeah, it's too hot. Yeah, right? We don't have enough resources. But I want you to really think about this. What are you doing to solve problems? You see, when I worked at NASA, they brought me in to solve a problem. They said, Kantis, right now, we have these planes, jets, shuttles, and we want to develop something called pressure-sensitive paint. You see, the planes and the wings of shuttles and aircraft, they had rivets in them. So it had this nice, long piece of material, and it had rivets like screws. And so we wanted to do some different things with the shuttle, different things with some of the fighter planes. And we wanted to make this material out of one long piece. And we wanted to put all of the sensors that were in the rivets. Because we are removing the rivets, we want to put it in the paint. And so now they said, Kantis, we need pressure-sensitive paint. When I worked at SIBA Vision, they said, Kantis, we have a problem. Contact lenses are falling on the ground. People can't find them on the ground or on their countertop. We need VisiTint. I couldn't go into the board meeting like this. So the question number 5, are you a whiner or a planner? When you see that we have low parent engagement, do what Ms. Cook is doing, right? Start instituting some things that we can apply and start using. Anybody see this movie? You watch this movie, this main character here in Ozark, they were trying to satisfy debt. They were pushing something. They had an agenda there to reach a goal. Here's the question for you. What are you pushing? I know the guy on Ozark is pushing, but what are you pushing? Meaning, if you teach science, if you teach history, if you teach math, are you pushing math so much that students say, wow, I love math. Math is so cool. Here's one thing I've learned about our generation, not our generation, but the younger generation, is that they will focus on whatever is cool, right? Whatever can grab their attention, they're hooked on it. One day it can be MySpace. The next day it can be Instagram stories. One day it can be the old Atari. Today it can be PlayStation. At one time it was Donkey Kong, but now, what's that game? Fortnite, right? So my question is, what are you pushing? What are you pushing so much that the students say, ah, I like this. Question number 7, who will you impact? I want you to think about a student. Maybe you can think about one person right now, one family right now, or maybe later on this afternoon, this evening, this week, you can think about a few students or a few families. And I want you to make it your business over the next 365 days to impact that family. I want you to go the extra mile to impact that family. There was a teacher, her name was Ms. Martin. And every single day, Ms. Martin, she would come to class, she would look me in my face, and she'd say, Kantis, you can be whatever you want to be. Ms. Martin, she would shake my hands. And I remember Ms. Martin, she would say the same thing my mom would say to me. And Ms. Martin would say, Kantis, give me a high 2. That simple phrase of give me a high 2 changed my life forever. Because she took a personal interest in me every single day. I don't mean to get emotional, but every time I think about that, I think about where I could end up, where I would have been. But it's because of people like you that a black guy from Decatur, Georgia, ended up working with rockets at NASA, living his dream, because somebody took the chance to say, Kantis, you can be whatever you want to be. And I know it gets hard. I know sometimes the money don't line up. But I want you guys to realize there are students, there are families that you're impacting every single day. And you may never know the impact that you make on their lives. Like, I don't know where Ms. Martin is right now. But if I could see her, I would take my 5'9" frame and be like, Ms. Martin, I love you. But that's the real deal. Who are you impacting? I want you to be intentional this year. You know what's going to come. You know what the politics and you know what the leadership is going to do. Just duck and keep doing what you do. And lastly, who is your champion? I want you to identify your champion. Maybe there's a teacher, maybe there's a professor, maybe there's a counselor, maybe there's a mentor, maybe there's somebody in another school district, maybe there's another school that you can model so that you can become better at your job. Who's your champion? Listen, I just want to give you guys these questions because at the end of the day, you can only control what you can control. As you can control what you can control, I believe that's the cure for burnout. Hey, if things are going on at school and it's affecting your household, if things going on at school is affecting your love life, handle stuff at school and get your love life right. Because it ain't cool to go home and your husband mad at you because you bringing all the books and the science beakers and stuff to bed. That ain't cool, man. Y'all know what I'm saying, right? Work-life balance. Listen, we only get one life. We only get this one opportunity. I want you guys to maximize it. 46% are dropping out or leaving. I want you guys to continue to dig in, to keep doing what you're doing. For all our newbies online that we're hazing this week, I want you to seriously think about this question, these questions. Because if this is not for you, go find something that is for you. Because when you don't give it your all, guess what? Your students feel it. Students are impacted. Was this helpful for you guys? Was this helpful for you? What's helpful for you? So As I leave here, my mom, as she was sitting there pushing my big head out, owie, owie, owie. My father wasn't at the hospital. He wasn't there, not because he was a deadbeat father, but he got stuck out on a business trip. And my dad called my mom, who was like, hey, the baby come out, the baby come out. My mom was like, our newborn baby. My dad said, what? She said, our newborn baby, he's missing some of his thinking. My dad said, sugar, sweetie, I need you to articulate. She said, Simmons, our newborn baby, he's missing some of his fingers. And then it got silent on the phone. And then my dad said, okay. He said, sugar. He said, sweetie. He said, honey lump. He said, even though our baby boy is missing some of his fingers, our baby boy, he will still be great. And Arizona teachers, I want to say to you, Kantis Simmons, my entire staff, thank you guys so much. And I know and I believe that you are great. Thank you guys so much.